property attorney. So you watched some of the hearing today. What really stood out for you? What concerned you most of what Christopher Wiley said?
Wiley used very powerful, significant rhetoric during his testimony, I thought, today. He really used some powerful phrasing like cyber warfare, talking about protecting cyberspace and social media users, just like you would protect people in the physical realm as well. And I think he was really using morally compass-guided language. He was really talking about right and wrong and trying to persuade people in a wrongful way, taking tactics that really he had issue with in terms of data privacy, social media, things like that.
Is he justified, though, to use those terms when you're talking about people's information so that they can be hit with certain kind of ads? You're not trying to find out information to kill people or to launch a military-style attack on them, so it seems a little bit strange.
At this point in time, though, look, it's May 2018. He's talking about cyber, basically the use of weaponized data, and I think you could make the comparison as to nuclear weapons or things happening in the physical world, because the way that social media really aggregates this kind of attention, really brings people together and can divide people, is very, very powerful. It's only going to get more powerful.
There's a saying, if something is for free, then you are the product, right? So if you use Facebook for free, then shouldn't you expect, isn't it only fair that Facebook gets to use and sell your data?
The problem is that Facebook, its user base has grown so significantly in 10 years. It's been around for over 10 years. We're talking about 2.2 billion users worldwide. But the problem is people didn't realize really what they're giving up when you sign on. And they have the terms and conditions. There's a saying that the privacy policies of Twitter, Facebook, Instagram, they're like at the reading level of Beowulf. They're extremely difficult. Nobody's actually reviewing them. You're going to look at the cliff notes and say yes. Right. So, and that's part of the issue now with what Facebook's dealing with and trying to strategize and change its consent policies so that users understand. They're still problematic. So, yes, I continually tell clients, you are the product when you're signing up for something that is technically for free. But still, people need to clearly understand. And these Facebook, all of these social media platforms have to have an explicit duty to be clear with their users.
They've said that they're going to try to meet that duty. They're going to try to take some steps. Should Facebook and their CEO, Mark Zuckerberg, be believed?
That's a great question, and I would love to believe Mark Zuckerberg. I think, though, this same issue has appeared since 2013, 2014. We've had similar scandals on Facebook with applications accessing data they really shouldn't have. Hopefully, this Cambridge Analytica scandal really brings to light this is could be considered the largest data breach in history at this point, 87 million users' data compromised. And hopefully, Zuckerberg, I think, realizes at this point things have to change, but unless users really start significantly dropping off, which they are not, will things actually change?
The Obama campaign also used Facebook users' data to go after voters. So what was the difference with this case?
Well, that's a really good point, and I think that's something we're going to see really fleshed out in the next coming weeks, which is how did Cambridge Analytica, how did similar data aggregating firms help these political campaigns? That's part of the problem. Whenever you're manipulating users into what content they're viewing, and Cambridge Analytica Wiley used the phrase psychoanalysis on what users were clicking on their profiles, trying to understand how to best reach potential voter pools and prey on their vulnerabilities. I think we're going to learn more about the Obama campaign's usage of these kinds of facilities in the coming weeks, but right now we see it with the Trump campaign.
But to Shana's point, I mean, micro-targeting in political campaigns goes back 30 years, where based on somebody's magazine subscriptions, you send a specific tailored kind of political message to their interests. It seems like this is the same thing. It may be on steroids in this case when it's online, but it doesn't feel like it's that new.
It's a great point, but in the context of social media where people are giving up thousands of data points every day, and not just your home address with a magazine subscription or what you're really looking at in terms of content, you're talking about all of your contacts, your daily activities, things that you like, things that you dislike, and really aggregating that data over, for some users, a span of 10 years. You can't imagine the type of psychoanalysis you can perform on someone like that. It's extremely valuable.
Is the difference here, though, that the way they got the data was they put this personality reality quiz out there, so people didn't understand they were giving their data that was going to go to political use. And let's say in the Obama campaign, people knew it was for political use.
That's a great point, Shana. There is a huge distinction between the veiled usage of these kinds of applications and what they're telling users they're for and what they're not. And that's part of the issue with the legality of Cambridge Analytica's tools, especially this personality quiz app. And right now, actually, Facebook has banned, they've stopped 200 different applications that are currently on the Facebook site because they're auditing them as well. This is part of the problem. Did they really explicitly tell users, hey, we're actually getting your data, we're getting your contacts data, and here's what we're going to do with it? And in an election campaign, in a political climate, you have to be very clear as to what you're doing if it's a political advertisement.
Right. Lisa Garber, cybersecurity attorney, thank you for your insight.
Thank you for having me.
Good to have you with us. Still to come on Crossroads, Anne Frank's risque secrets have been...